Welcome to Fundamentals. This is a series hosted by Spatial Practice at Central St Martin's and convened and chaired. Oops, that's the gong. And convened and chaired by our guest, who is Ollie Wainwright, who is, as many of you may know, a journalist, writer, and the Guardian's architecture critic. I'm Mel Dodd. I'm the program director, and I'm really just giving a very quick minute to say hello, to welcome you, and also to welcome especially external guests. So we have quite a large group of external guests, which is fantastic. We were sold out. This series has really generated a huge amount of popular interest, which is amazing. But also to welcome students and staff of Spatial Practices and the wider college who are interested. Very quickly, why here, why now? I think that our programme, which consists of architecture courses, BA, MA and narrative environments, is really driven and interested in the wider context of what makes the city, forces that go perhaps beyond traditional architectural voices and interests and into other conditions, infrastructures, social, civil, legal, political and so forth. So this alignment and this series is really good, in a way, a synopsis of what we're interested in. And it seems like it's also very interesting for the wider London realm at the moment. So broadly speaking, Ollie will introduce, but I just wanted to say a couple of housekeeping things. First of all, it's a debate, and we'll pass over at a point to the audience, so get your questions ready. There's a roaming microphone. We really want you to participate. That's the point. And secondly, we have a bar at the end of the college, and after the debate, we'll be able to move down there. It can get a little bit noisy. It's a bit of a student bar, but it's still worth going, and you can continue the debate in that scenario. So enjoy, and I'll pass over to Ollie.
Well, thank you, Mel, and thank you all for coming. I should say, as I did last week, that it's a pleasure to be in this rare thing, which is an architecture school in London that actually engages with reality. The students aren't designing trout farms on Mars, they're engaging with the planning system and the fundamentals of land economy, which is, I guess, what I try and do in my own writing, trying to kind of expose the often invisible forces and networks that actually end up shaping the city and shaping the future of London. So we kicked off a couple of weeks ago with housing. Last week we had a session on planning, tonight is about land. Next week will be about industry and the kind of pressures facing productive space in London being relentlessly driven out of the city. Where will we make things in future? The week after that, 16th of February, a session on public art and the role of artists in regeneration. Are they always going to be consigned to kind of providing the final garnish to the soulless public space, or can they have a more meaningful role in development? And finally, there'll be a debate about landscape. Is gardening now being used as a kind of fig leaf, a greenwash to disguise the evils of development, or can it be used in a more beneficial way? Not a loaded question there. So tonight, land, I'm so glad you came, because to me it's the most fundamental of all of the fundamentals. It lies at the very roots of all six of the topics. It's the thing I think most kind of at the foundation of our current crisis. Crisis of workspace, crisis of housing, general crisis of the direction London is moving in. Why? Let's start with a famous quote. Mark Twain famously said, "Buy land because they're not making it anymore." It's a finite commodity. It's actually quite difficult to buy. I don't know, hands up anyone who's actually tried to buy a bit of land. Okay, a few. Not many. As they'll be able to tell you, it's quite hard. There isn't a directory of bits of land that are for sale. When you do finally find a bit, it's very difficult to know how much to pay for it. No one knows how much land is worth. It's basically worth whatever people are willing to pay for it. The value of land, I suppose, is regulated by a number of things, but essentially planning permission is what defines how valuable a plot of land is. The average price of a field in England, according to the Valuation Office, is about £21,000 per hectare. If you get planning permission for housing on that field, it's worth £6 million per hectare. So just that process of getting planning permission is a kind of 300 times uplift in the value of your asset. That's the average. In London, obviously, it's way more. A hectare of land with planning permission in the City of London is £100 million per hectare. So where does that value go? I mean, in my mind, the planning system was invented in 1947 to capture that kind of value uplift and essentially keep it for the community, to, you know, in the interests of the people of the city. The planning system has now mutated to such an extent that the permission is essentially given away for free to the developer, and all of that windfall goes to the landowner. Even when there's public investment now in the city, so say a new park or a new station, the value uplift of the surrounding land, again, that all goes to the landowner. There's no way of that value of public investment actually being clawed back and kept in the community. It's what John Stuart Mill famously called the unearned increment. Okay, you know, a way of kind of creaming off profit without actually doing anything. But worse than that, it spawned an entire industry of essentially land trading, of people who only exist to get planning permission on plots of land with no intention of ever building that planning permission as a way of raising the value of the land and selling it on. And that's a process that can happen again and again and again before that land ever gets into the hands of people that actually want to build something, by which time they'll have paid so much for that piece of land that the only option is to build executive homes or luxury flats. It's kind of built into the model of speculative development. I'm sure lots of people might disagree with that who are about to speak. At the same time, we've got this whole crisis of land banking, because there's no incentive to build once you've got your planning permission. There's nothing actually encouraging developers to build anything, because it's often more lucrative to sit on that land and wait for values to rise. The UK's biggest house builders between them are sitting on 600,000 plots of land with planning permission. That's twice the number of homes that we managed to build last year. And that process is essentially keeping values high, but also preventing people that want to build from getting access to that land. It's kind of blocking the system. So how can we solve this? Hopefully our five speakers tonight might have some of those answers. Let's see if I have a... I should mention, actually, log on to the cloud for live tweeting. Use the hashtag fundamentals. Do we have a list? Okay, no. I'll go back to this. So our five speakers, we've got Toby Lloyd, who is the head of development at Shelter. Then we're going to have Beth Stratford, who's a PhD student on post-growth economics at Leeds University. Following her, we'll have Joe Sarling, who's a planning works with a planning consultancy, Nathaniel Litchfield and Partners. Then we'll be hearing from Kate Swade from Shared Assets. And finally, Stephen Hill, who's the director of C2O Future Planners. I'll introduce them properly before they each speak. They're each going to have 5 minutes, and then there'll be the magic land gong, where they have to stop suddenly, and then we'll have general discussion on the daytime TV sofas, and I'll hand it over to you guys to grill them. So be thinking about the urgent issues and questions you want to challenge them on while they're speaking. So the first 5 minutes is going to be taken by Toby Lloyd, head of development at Shelter. He's worked in housing policy across the public and private and voluntary sectors for over 10 years and joined Shelter as head of policy in 2011. He specializes in improving housing supply and was runner-up in the Wolfson Economic Prize in 2014 for Shelter's proposal for a new garden city. And now a little plug for his book. He's author with Josh Ryan Collins and Laurie McFarlane of Rethinking the Economics of Land and Housing, which will be essential reading for tonight's discussion. So over to Toby.
Thank you, Ollie, and thank you for the book plug. Most importantly, because what I'm going to say here is actually taken from the book. It's actually got nothing to do with Shelter, and please don't tell my employers if I say anything stupid, because they didn't vet it. This is all me. Where's my thing? Okay, so what I'm going to do here, because we've got such an excellent panel of people who really know everything I would possibly have said, they'll be able to say far better than I will on most of the issues relating to the kind of the land system and how it affects development and housing today. I thought I'd do a very, very quick canter through the historical background. Basically, what is land and how is it owned? Because that is the critical function of land in the economy. So this is, deep breaths, I'm going to have to talk quickly, the entire history of property ownership in 5 minutes and 11 pictures of dead white males. So the first is a feudal monarch. I think that was actually Harold, but you know, it could be anyone. In the feudal era, effectively, no one owned land. Ownership, did not, as we know it now, did not really exist in landed property. Land was held of the king, and there were even kind of theological notions that the king kind of held it of God. But essentially, the feudal structure was one in power relations controlled by violence and you know, through military obligations up and down the chain, and through kind of use rights. People had different use rights to bits of land depending on their position in the hierarchy. It was not an ownable or tradable commodity. That all changed in the time of Henry VIII, when the art had got considerably better, because effectively, when Henry VIII nationalised the monasteries, he then had a huge amount of land, which he didn't know what to do with. He also had a huge amount of debt to pay off, so he sold it. He sold it to, effectively, the people who had cash, who were the emerging new mercantile class, who were desperate to get the kind of kudos and status that came with being landowners, and that effectively overnight created a whole new class of commercial private land ownership. Accidentally, at that point, England created a brand new concept of private property in land. And from then on, land becomes something much more like how we know it now, an asset like any other that you can trade and you can buy. The effect was phenomenal. The economic impact was colossal. It led to the birth of capitalism, massive increases in agricultural productivity, and whenever you get a big increase in productivity, what does that mean? All the people that were previously producing stuff lose their jobs and end up indigent and poor. And about a third of the population ended up more or less homeless by this point. So huge birth of capitalism, massive social consequences. Jump forward 100 years, capitalism gets a new turbo boost with the birth of finance. Where these two gentlemen, both Scottish entrepreneurs who founded national banks, William Paterson, the Bank of England, John Law, the Bank of France. Amazing story, which I won't go into, but look it up, it's great. Effectively, by creating a new concept of finance, money that could be created more or less out of nothing in the form of credit, what they needed was assets for this to be secured against. And of course, land is the perfect asset. The combination of land as property, which could be bought, sold, and traded, and money really created the modern financial economy that we know. From then onwards, capitalism is really getting going. It's far more productive. You get the birth of new industries. You get much more social mobility. You get new classes of people with something to lose. They start demanding political power. You start getting revolutions, not least the English Civil War. Lots more social conflict, but also the birth of democracy, the emergence of checks and balances on royal power. And so this is effectively the catalyst for the emergence of democracy, much more social mobility, the emergence of economic growth, but also conflict, dispossession, enclosure, people thrown off their traditional land, much more poverty, the rise of urban slums. Inevitably, that means when you now have a well-versed kind of economy emerging, you get people studying it, and economics is born. The first thing that most of the early economists, this is Adam Smith, noticed is that landowners were onto a really good number here. Because whatever they did, they seemed to make more money. The more the economy grew, and remember the whole concept of economic growth really stems from this period. Before then, economies either didn't grow or weren't understood to grow. They noticed that landowners were seemingly able just to pocket the entire proceeds of growth without really doing anything to deserve it. This is what's known as the problem of rent. And essentially, this is what we paraphrase as the paradox of property. The creation of property in land has enabled both huge productivity, much more social mobility, democracy, loads of kind of great things, but it has also created rent, poverty, exploitation, exclusion. How are these two things possible at the same time? And what, more importantly, do you do about it? Political philosophers came up with various different responses. Rousseau just said, you know, clearly property was a mistake. We've got to tear it all up. We've got to go back to a kind of unowned state of, he saw it as a kind of fantastical state of nature where everything was in common. Basically reject the very concept of property in land. John Locke, on the other hand, tied himself in massive intellectual knots trying to come up with a justification for property that would somehow fit with his kind of liberal ideas of human rights, because the creation of property was also bound up with the Enlightenment concept of individual rights and individual liberty. Whether you think he succeeded or not is not really the point. My favorite is Proudhon, the French anarchist, who said most famously that property is theft. In other words, he was with Rousseau. But he also said that property is liberty. In other words, he agreed with Locke. And our proposition in the book is that Proudhon was right. Both statements are true. Property is theft, but it is also liberty. The question is how you balance these two out. It seems to be historically that up to a point, the creation of property and the distribution of property rights seems to generate actually quite a lot of social and economic goods, up to a point. Beyond a certain point, it starts to tip, and you start to get much more exclusion, entrenchment of landowner power, the erosion of democracy, increasing poverty, inequality, and so forth. The question, therefore, is where is that point, and what do you do about it? Well, by the end of the 19th century, this problem was getting quite acute, and so here are two possible solutions to it. Henry George, on the left there, advocated taxing land, capture the rent through the tax system through a land value tax. Keir Hardy here, I could have put Marx up, but I thought I'd do Keir Hardy instead, suggested you nationalise it. Socialise the rent by simply nationalising all land. Both of these solutions were really heavily in play by the end of the 19th century because the problem of rent had got so acute. By now, the key bits of land were no longer the bits that grew food. They were the bits underneath railways, underneath factories, i.e. the economically productive bits. I can see the gong coming out.
Bonus minute.
All right. Lloyd George came up with a different solution, i.e. home ownership. In the 20th century, we simply moved to a new system of redistribution of landed property. From now onwards, the key bits of land are not farms, not fields, not factories or railways, but homes. The 20th century, as Beth will cover better than I can, is essentially the story of that entire cycle of landed property going through a phase of redistributing wealth, generating much more social equality and mobility, and up to a point, and then that point turns in the late 20th century, and we start to see it going back the other way. What you can see is that during the 20th century, private renting collapsed as people got other options. They were able to own their own homes, they were able to rent socially off the state. The problem of rent was being solved through the housing system. But then in the late 20th century, for lots of reasons we can talk about later, those old patterns started to reassert themselves. Old monopolies start coming back. Private renting in London is about to become the single largest tenure. We are back in the 19th century, back in the 18th century, as the problem of rent has reasserted itself. So the challenge for us for the rest of this debate, I would say, is how do we solve the problem of rent without losing all of the benefits that private property also brought?
Incredible, an entire history of land in 6 minutes. If I can make this work, we're going to have Beth Stratford up next, potentially, or a purple screen. I'll just introduce her while we get this sorted out. Oh, here we go, that's fine. Beth's doing a PhD at Leeds University on post-growth economics and the housing market. She's convened two major conferences on financial reform and has worked as a lecturer, filmmaker, editor, and a climate campaigner. My favourite fact about Beth is that she once hijacked a train that was en route to Drax Power Station.
So maybe... That was not in the bio.
So over to Beth.
Thank you. There's a little thing in the way here. Let's move that. So I've been asked to kind of give an overview of the interactions between the land market, the housing market, and the mortgage market. House prices and land prices are obviously intimately linked, and if you wanted convincing of that, the pink line there is an index of house prices, the blue line is the index of land prices. What's driving that relationship is, one of the things that's driving that relationship is, of course, the way that land prices are bid up by developers. So the first thing a developer will do when they're deciding how much they're going to bid for a piece of land is obviously think about how much the finished houses are going to fetch on the open market. That's the top level here. Then they might think, okay, well, how much do we want? What do we want our profit margin to be? What's our contribution going to be to affordable housing and local infrastructure? What are we going to spend on the actual build itself? And whatever is left over is what they have left to bid for the land. So you can see already that, I mean, this is a highly sort of aggressively competitive market. So you can see already that it's the companies that tend to squeeze these elements that are going to end up winning that bid. And this image that I've nicked off Toby himself, actually. So he'd probably explain this better than me. But you can already see that one thing that drives land prices up is, of course, when the planners themselves end up being flexible and giving in on insisting on getting their affordable housing provision and insisting on getting a contribution to infrastructure and don't maintain minimum decent quality build standards. But the other thing, and I think the more important thing that drives land prices is, as I mentioned before, what developers expect to be able to fetch on the open market for the houses. And that, as we all know, is determined by supply and demand in the housing market. Now, normally I would talk about the dysfunctions on both sides of this equation. I don't have time, obviously, in 5 minutes. So I'm going to focus on the demand side, because that is what is so frequently neglected. We're told over and over again that the reason we have a housing crisis is because of a shortage of houses. But actually, if you look at the data, the scale of the booms and busts we've seen, the timing of them, the geographical variation cannot be explained by shortages of housing. You have to look at what's going on the demand side. Demand is a function of the number of buyers that are seeking to buy houses. That's not just people who are seeking to houses to live in, obviously, that's also people who are seeking an investment. The strength of preference, which is, you know, an economist's term for the strength of desire to buy that house over buying some stocks and shares, for example. And the purchasing power that buyer has to back up their preference. Obviously, a preference to buy a house only becomes effective demand if you've got the money to back it up. These kinds of headlines would lead us to believe that the main thing driving demand is swarms of more people coming and wanting homes to live in. I would argue that is really not the main thing. The two key shifts that have affected the inflation of demand are, I think the ones that I'm going to, there's quite a lot that I could say here, but the really key things that I think are important to stress are the way in which the way we think about houses has shifted in our imagination from somewhere to live to them being a financial asset. And you can see that it's evidenced, obviously, in the increase in buy-to-let investment, the increase in foreign investment, but also the willingness of ordinary people to bid, to take on debt that in other circumstances would be completely insane. They're taking on levels of debt because they're expecting their house to function like a financial asset, right? So there's that's taken place, and there's also a massive expansion in purchasing power that's taken place. So, and in fact, I just had an illustration of homes turning into financial assets. I have to walk past this car every day, and it drives me completely insane. I'm going to get a spray can out one of these days. Governments, I think, have been at best complicit in this shift of homes into being seen as financial assets, and at worst, I think they've actively encouraged that shift, and I'll come back to talk about that probably in the Q&A because I won't have time just now. But the real thing I want to stress here is the way in which easy mortgage credit has expanded the purchasing power in the housing market. Because if you think about it, you've got this bidding war going on. If the amount of money to back up that bidding war was limited by existing savings, then it could only go so far, right? There'd be a limit. It would be limited by the amount of money that's already in circulation sitting in bank accounts. But of course, when most people buy a house, they're not relying only on their savings, they're relying on money loaned from banks. And as hopefully most of you in this room will understand now, when banks create a loan, they are creating brand new money that never existed before. So they are increasing aggregate purchasing power in the mortgage, in the housing market. Now, from the 1980s, the willingness and ability of banks to create that money expanded really dramatically due to deregulation, changes in the structure of the banking sector, and innovation, principally something called securitization, which, again, I'm very happy to talk about in more detail if we've got time in the Q&A. But the upshot of those processes is a few things happened. One is that interest rates dropped really, really dramatically from the mid-90s. The riskiness, the willingness of banks to extend risky loans increased. So this is the loan-to-income ratios, the percentage of mortgages lent at different loan-to-income ratios. The loan-to-income ratio is like, here's the size of the loan and here's the size of the income of the borrower. A higher loan-to-income ratio is obviously more risky from the point of view of the bank. So we saw lots more of that risky lending. And the upshot of both of that is, of course, a massive increase in the amount of money being pushed into the housing market. And so, one of the things that I find slightly... This graph is showing gross mortgage lending. And one of the things I find quite startling and alarming is that we're back up almost at the levels of gross bank lending that we had before the financial crisis. I could talk a little bit about why that lending has not dried up as much as you might expect it to have. One of the key reasons is that the buy-to-let lending has been unaffected by these new affordability tests that everybody else has to meet. So buy-to-let lenders, borrowers can still get interest-only mortgages, whereas the rest of us aren't really generally able to do that. So we've had a 40% increase in buy-to-let lending since the crash, only a 2% increase in everybody else is lending. So the thing, that just before I get a second gong, if I'm sure it's coming in a minute, the thing that I think is so problematic about this is the feedbacks that happen between bank lending and speculative behaviour and land prices. I'll stop there, but I'll have more to say about that later. Okay, great. And there's that.
Amazing. Wow. What a mind map. We could keep on going all night through this. Incredible. Thanks, Beth. Let me just switch back to the main computer. So, next up we have Joe Sarling, I think. Yes. Who is an associate director at the planning and economics consultancy Nathaniel Litchfield and Partners. Joe heads up the research team undertaking market and policy analysis across a range of topics, notably housing and land. Recently, Joe and NLP have published research reports on housing delivery, planning timescales, house builder business models, and permissions. So over to Joe.
Thank you. So we were invited to be agitational, and I'm going to be agitational tonight. The key thing for me is that there's no evidence of house builders or land promoters or developers, land banking, and actually planning system holds the key to releasing more land for homes. There's no, a few kind of boos,
ooh.
That's fine.
Ooh.
Yeah, I like this, this is good. Okay, so as we've already discussed in a variety of ways, lots of things impact on lots of other things. That sounds terribly glib, but the land market and development market is no different here. Here's a very simple diagram. There's lots more on my Twitter account. But the key things I'm going to talk about tonight are planning, also democracy. That is a democratic process. It's difficult. It's challenging. It provides extra timescales for things, but it's a useful process, but can be improved. Land and spatial variation. These are the three things I'm going to talk about when we think about development. I won't go through all of this. We don't have time. I think every speaker is going to say that at every slide, but we genuinely don't have time. But this is the development process. So as soon as you want to try and build something, this is the process by which that happens. It's incredibly complicated. There's various feedback loops. There's risk at virtually every single point. What I really wanted to highlight here, and this is just for housing, of course, there's lots of different types here. What I really wanted to highlight here is the role of local plans at a council level. At the start, a local plan sets out land use within that local area. Part of that is for housing. Now, of course, they need to allocate a certain amount of land for that housing. If they don't allocate enough land for that housing, then the plan will not be found sound, and so will be thrown out. One of the key issues here is that in order to have land in that plan, land needs to come forwards. And often that relies on land promoters doing this, hence the principal planning risk. They end up trying to, they knock on doors of farmers, they try and bring together land, they try and make a deal so that that land and the owners within that setup will want to come and sell that land in order to have that land allocated within the plan. That's a huge amount of risk. Someone's stumping up cash for this. That's a lot of risk. That's a lot of money. They're shouldering it privately. There's no public risk attached to that at the moment. Then there's detailed planning risk. Detailed planning risk is obviously when it goes into further detail about the exact, what's actually going to be built, the tenure mix, and all of those kind of things. The reason I'm telling you this is twofold. The takeaway from this is twofold. Firstly, is that local plan process is really important. That's how we use land. And if we want more homes, we need more land, and that's the process. Secondly, is that there's a huge amount of risk. And at the moment, it's shouldered privately. So when we think about land coming forwards, and to use an earlier quote, land is given away for free to developers, actually, they're spending a decent amount of cash to try and get it done in the first place. Local plans are important. That's a dramatic pause. I enjoyed that. I didn't mean that. I should write that in. Local plans are important. So what's the coverage of local plans across the country? Well, about 34% of local areas have an up-to-date post-MPPF local plan that's found sound. So if that's the key mechanism by which we try and get land through, try and get homes built on that land and allocated, it's a pretty poor state of affairs, and it's across the country. Indeed, the ratio there, the percentage of plans that are found sound within areas that have greenbelt is really reduced. And I definitely want to flag in and around the London area here at this point. If they don't, I mean, they're shire counties, they often don't, resistant to more and additional housing, but a lot of the plans that are not found sound are in and around the London area. That has huge implications for house building more broadly. So local plans are important, the coverage is not particularly good at the moment. Hence why we get this notion of speculation is because promoters have to come in, they say, look, we really want to build here. It goes through a long process, a long democratic process, but nonetheless, it's a long process. The longer something goes on, the more risk that's attached, more likelihood that the business cycle works against you. It's a really risky business. I mean, trying to bring land forwards in order to build homes and then to start building your first home might take 5, 6, 7 years. If a business cycle is 12 to 15 years, you have pretty much a 50% chance of trying to build through a really difficult downturn in terms of the economics. That's just risky. So that's why the profit margin is attached, to try and account for that risk. A few quick things. This is land price. London is the pink line. Greenfield land in the UK is the green line, and the blue line is urban land within the UK. London is nuts. I'm not going to dispute that. London is crazy. The land price has exploded. It's much higher than the pre-crash peak. London is crazy. The rest of the country is not crazy. So does that mean the system's completely failed? Do we need to overhaul the entire system? Well, maybe not. Maybe it's just London. Maybe London's the crucial issue here. So maybe we just need to tweak the current system. Maybe we don't need a massive reform. London land prices are pretty crazy. And indeed, this is reflected in house prices too. If we compare it to the pre-crash peak back in 2008, London is still nuts. That's unsurprising. Most of us are renters. It's crazy in London. And indeed, that spills over then throughout London, hence my point about local plans around the London border. The southeast has had huge increases, east of England also. Compared in real terms to the pre-crash peak, those prices are higher. The rest of the country, not so high. And indeed, it's kind of flatlining too. So is there speculation everywhere? Is the system completely failed everywhere? Not necessarily. The overspill point, and this is really important. So as part of the London plan, they said that we need something around 49,000 to 62,000 homes each and every year. But London can't produce that number of homes. They said, OK, we can build 42,000. OK, so where's the rest of those going to go? Well, it's going to be overspill. But remember, that overspill happens in places that don't have local plans. That's a real challenge. And particularly if we're going to hold Greenbelt land sacrosanct, if we don't build in the direct flow, it's then going to go out further and further and further. That notion is really important. How much overspill is there going to be? What can the mayor do to make this a London discussion? What can the mayor do? Well, he has very few powers, is there? And we'll come on to that point. Very few powers in general. He's started having some draft guidance about how we measure viability and those kind of things, which we definitely should come on to as part of the discussion. So that's a flag if anybody wants to ask about that. And also the New London Plan coming out in 2019, and indeed the London Finance Commission suggesting more greater devolution of taxes, particularly LVT, which will be important. Before I get the second gong, and I'll flow on from that very briefly, I wanted to highlight this. And this will be really important for our discussion, because at the moment, a lot of the discussion will be about, we work in the current system, let's overhaul everything and create a new system. Now, I have no doubt that if we all sat down with no system in place, we would come up with something really useful. There's a big difference between the merits, discussing the merits of current system versus a new system, and moving from the current system to that new system. They are very different things, and we should be aware of that when we come up with the discussions. Oh, nice.
Fantastic. You know, thanks for a lot of meat for our discussion later on. So next we are going to have, let's see, Kate Swade from Shared Assets. So Kate is a director of Shared Assets, which is a land-focused think and do tank. It's a not-for-profit company set up to provide advice, support, and training, undertake research, and advocate for changes in the way we manage land. Kate's background is in community-led property and neighborhood regeneration, primarily in London. Over to Kate.
Thank you. Thanks very much. I have a fun little handbag for the microphone, so I may fall over it or something, or like fling it if I gesticulate a bit too much. So apologies in advance for that. So lands. I'm going to try and zoom out a bit. As Ollie said, shared assets is a think and do tank, which means we basically do lots of thinking and lots of practical work. We try and grapple a lot with that thing about a potential new system and this current system that we exist within. And so we work with people who are mainly doing things on land that doesn't have a roof. So parks, green spaces, agricultural lands, woodlands, waterways, these kind of things. We do lots of consultancy work, we do lots of advice, we also do lots of thinking about what the barriers are and the problems are with the current system and what a different type of way of looking at this stuff might look like. And that's what I want to mainly focus on. Obviously, everyone is saying tonight that land is fundamental, but I think it does really bear repeating. It's something that isn't has been very much neglected in policy terms. And one of the reasons we set up shared assets was recognizing that there are real common issues between people who are trying to do interesting things with woodlands and people who are trying to do interesting things with urban parks, with people who are trying to sort out the food system and people who are trying to make more affordable housing. They're all land issues. And so it's one of the things we want to do is try and draw these dots. So currently, the way we talk about lands seems to fall into one of two camps. It's either this thing of land as an asset class, and these are two things that I kind of shamelessly screenshotted from a Savills report on the agricultural and forestry market and a Financial Times article. But so I won't dwell on that too much because I think we've been talking about that quite a lot. But the other kind of half of that paradigm is that land is there as something to be conserved or preserved, and it's somehow something fragile that needs a fence around it. And I think we're dissatisfied with both of those narratives. It's this thing of it's either the market or the state and some kind of protectionist thing. And we think we need a new relationship with land that maybe strikes a bit of a third way between the two of them. So we've come up with a bit of a framework, which is still just a bit of a first stab at being able to say, what are the things that we think could make a more sustainable land system? And we've called it common good land use, and very sort of deliberately trying to position land as something, I suppose, we're coming at this with a belief that land, regardless of who owns it, is a shared resource for the community. If you pollute your land, it affects me. If I build a terrible house on my land, it will affect you. Regardless of ownership and for formal powers, there is a shared element to land that you don't have with many other types of assets. So we think land should be, people should be able to create livelihoods from land, whether that's in urban or rural areas. We think that, and some of this feels like stating kind of the bleeding obvious, but it doesn't always happen, that land management should benefit the environment, that the systems, the tax and the subsidy systems that we set up should encourage that rather than discourage that. And I think crucially, particularly in the urban context, we do think land should be productive. We're not conservationists. We think we should be using land and having a relationship with that, whether that's producing food or fuel or space for people to stare at the sky and generally kind of think about themselves, or sports or recreation. Making sure there is that productivity in almost all of the land that we have feels very important to us. And this is, I suppose, one of the ones which could be challenging. But we think there should be mechanisms to share the benefits that come from land, whether that's financial uplift or other goods, with the people who live and the communities who surround that land. Whether that's a share in the uplift from the housing development, whether that's a non-polluting farming method that doesn't then mess everything up downstream, it will look different in different contexts. We think there should be some element of community control. We think, again, regardless of who owns the land, people do have a right to have a say in what happens to the space around them. The planning system does go some way towards that, but it's not the most inclusive or easy thing to engage in. And this is where we come back into the what's the new system versus what's the current system. We believe we do need to be working, that a lot in the current system isn't working, but that if we don't take land as a fundamental starting point for designing the new system, we will end up neglecting it and we will end up with some of the same problems that we have now. Three very quick examples of people we think are doing this. Organically, up in Walthamstow, food growing, vegetable boxes, they do lots of training. They're in one way a big garden centre, but they're much, much more. It's very slow. Myers Fields, it's a public park, pretty much community run, much, much more than a public park. Many, many good things happening there. And these guys in Peterborough, partly I just put them in because after 5 years, they have now got a lease on the land that they have been on for the past 12. They have been fighting against the development site. It's a wonderful community garden. They finally got a deal with the council. It's really good. So look all these guys up. They're great. So our main message here, I guess, is that we need to shift the narrative. We need to start talking about land more. We helped convene a conference at the end of last year called Land for What that brought together housing and food and anti-gentrification activists to start looking at this stuff through a lens of land. If you go to landforwhat.org.uk, there's much more information there. We need to get people talking about land in the pub. We need to make sure, get people realising that these issues are land issues. They're not just housing issues. And we need to begin to think about seeding conversations that might lead to a considered transition to a different type of system or a different way of thinking about how we own and make decisions about land, which hopefully segues into Stephen's presentation quite nicely. So thank you very much.
If you could keep that on for the... Great, thanks, Kate. I love the idea of land in the pub. Last week we had planning in the pub. So now land in the pub. Make sure you all go to landforwhat.org.uk to keep up with the next conferences. So last but not least, we have Stephen Hill, who's the director of C2O Future Planners. Stephen is a chartered planning and development surveyor, working as an independent public interest practitioner with 40 years of public and private sector experience of housing, planning and delivering mixed-use development, urban extensions, new settlements and community-led neighbourhood regeneration. And he's currently drafting a private member's land reform bill, which I think he's going to talk to us about tonight. Over to Stephen.
Thank you, everybody. By now, you've probably gathered that unless we have some kind of a revolution, nothing is going to change. Even from very mildly spoken people like Kate. Unfortunately, we don't have a terribly good record of revolutions in this country without chopping people's heads off or shedding a lot of blood and needless violence. So my challenge is, how do we get from here to there without that? And how do we understand the power and the politics that we have to exercise in order to get there? So that's really a reflection on this. Just to make sure you're all paying attention, I'm going to ask you, what do these three things have in common? Your parents, baby boomers, and the land. What have they all got in common?
They sold us short.
Sold us short? Not bad. Not bad. Any other offers?
I'm a late baby boomer, born in 1954. And 2 weeks ago, I paid off my mortgage. So I'm an owner of a chunk of beautiful land with fantastic views over the landscape.
Okay. Anything a bit more visceral? people know your Philip.
They're not us.
You know your Philip Larkin? They fuck you up. And which of those things do you think fucks you up the most?
Land.
Okay. And these are some of the things, you know, we've heard about them today. The thing that particularly appeals to me is, you know, I will have made more in the rise in the price of my house than I will ever have paid in taxes. So I have lived a tax-free life. So who is paying for all the public goods that we all enjoy? The people who don't own. Right, now some reflections on politics and power. If you're a student and you haven't read any Zygmunt Bauman by now, you're sadly lacking. This is a very simple definition, disarming in its way, Politics is deciding what to do, and power is working out how you're going to make it happen. And his rather depressing diagnosis, he died just a few weeks ago, is that at the moment, nobody is actually in control. So what do powerful politicians look like? Well, here's some characteristics of a politician that you might know. Hands up for this guy. Who thinks I'm talking about him? Come on, put your hands up. If you think I'm talking about him? All right, okay, a few. Anybody got any other ideas about who I might be talking about? No? How about this guy? All of those things. And he was particularly fond and actually good of building walls himself. They're a very interesting contrast. At the moment, President Trump is in a situation where he's doing no politics. It's all power. It's the raw exercise of power, independent of the political system. It'll be interesting to see how far he gets. Churchill, on the other hand, interesting case, a bit of both. And the particular reason I've chosen him is that when he was a young man, and he defected first from the Conservatives to the Liberals, he, with Lloyd George and that Liberal government before the First World War, were very instrumental in bringing forward land reform. This is an amazing speech. If you're interested, find it. He was addressing a very well-to-do audience in the Theatre Royal, Drury Lane. This is a very Trumpian approach. We have against us all the money power. We have to deal with the apathy and levity of all sections of the public, i.e. you people in the audience. You're the problem. And it's all about land and how he describes land, speculating in land, as an act of plunder. And actually, he's on the side of production. But the thing about this is that although they were a political party that actually won three general elections in the space of 4 years, with this in their manifesto, land value tax and development tax, and they still didn't manage it. So, if we think about 100 years later, the House of Lords was definitely a problem then. It certainly isn't now. The case for land value taxation is completely rational, compelling. Even the most neoliberal of neoliberal economists, Milton Friedman, says so. But people still say it's too difficult. It's too technically difficult. This is a smokescreen. It's not difficult. We can do it with stuff that's on the internet today. It's because the political difficulties are too great. So, why hasn't it happened? Well, just think of some practical questions. Lloyd George and Churchill and his contemporaries, they were big political beasts. And over a period of 20 to 30 years, they still didn't manage to carry it off. So if you were to find a politician today, a chancellor who would understand how you have to remake the taxation landscape for a start, where would you find that kind of politician in any political party?
Holland.
I think there's a real shortage of candidates. Which party would even dare attempt it? You know, this is a classic Liberal Party policy, but they're not a power at the moment. If the Labour Party did it, they would never survive the death by a thousand cuts from the Daily Mail. Marxism, Stalinism, the lot. So the reality is that we've got to rely on the Conservatives to do this, maybe with a bit of cross-party progressive support, but that is the reality. Okay. Prefiguring the revolution, how do you do something that doesn't frighten people to death? So what would a land reform policy look like that gave priority to the sort of things that Kate is talking about? And what is the minimum intervention in law that you would need to make, at least to start the process going? So here's a very simple idea. This is what a private interest lease looks like at the moment. Lord Salisbury there on the top, freehold landowner. Lots of things going on in his ownership. He's directly farming some land. He's let off a bit of land on a short lease to people to run holiday homes, and he's doing a deal with a nameless housing developer who's not building any houses anytime soon. How do you deal with that? You insert a public interest lease. A community body, suitably accredited with a clear public interest purpose, can insert itself as a head lease. Nothing changes, no blood is shed, and they can then start to make alternative proposals about how you would use that land more productively, which might look like this. Leave Lord Salisbury to farm his land, you turn the holiday homes into a wildlife reserve, and you turn all those homes not being built into community land trusts, which will be built now, not over the next 10 years. You'd need a land reform bill. I can talk about these during the discussions, but basically three very simple things are needed. You need to define what the well-being test or the public interest test would be. You have to have proper interest, public interest and valuation compensation rules, and you need to allow some things to be accepted. Graveyards is a classic case. But the really important thing is this, and this is my finishing point, we actually need a cultural revolution. But again, nothing like the cultural revolution we've seen in other countries. This is in which the politicians have a role, the professionals have a role, my own profession. Its Royal Charter from the Victorian era says one of the main jobs of surveyors is to secure the optimal use of land to meet social and economic need. What could be simpler than that? And do they do it? 2018 is our 150th anniversary year. And there is a programme of work which the profession is now undertaking to redefine the public interest and, in a sense, to give itself a new image. But centrally, this is you people in the room, we the people. This diagram here is basically describing a working, lively, democratic civil society process. And ours is in a terrible state of disrepair. We have got to get off our backsides and do some of this ourselves. So the people who will make the change are the people who are doing stuff, people like Kate and her organisations, actually making stuff, policy making by doing. There's a role for think tanks, campaign groups, local politics, but unless we start going out and actually leading by example and doing stuff on the ground and show what the alternative looks like, nothing will ever happen. And we'll be left to this man. This is a great quote here from Churchill. I haven't got time to read it out, and I would slip into fake Churchillian accent. But you could think, you know, if which side is President Trump, the property developer tycoon, on? I would say he's on the side of plunder. Thank you.
Excellent. Well, can I invite all five speakers to join me on the daytime TV sofas? Maybe we'll leave it with the revolution slide on as our backdrop. Come on, if you all can read the quote. So, I mean, so much has been covered, but I think one of the main common threads that was evident in all of your talks was that the current process of development, the value uplift that we have in securing permission for a development, at the moment, not enough of it goes to the common good. And that's something we could probably all agree on, potentially. And I'm just interested in five responses of what mechanisms we could introduce in our current development scenario that would help to share that value uplift somehow with the community. How can the unearned increment be spread kind of more broadly and help a wider demographic? What things would you introduce? What policies? What mechanisms? Wants to go first.
the easiest one that can actually be done now is just the traditional old-fashioned route of the state. You know, the Newtown Development Corporations did this really effectively. You know, they were set up by statute, they drew lines on the map and said, right, we can now compulsory purchase all of that land at its current value, give ourselves planning permission, build a whole new town, sell plots of land at the newly inflated value. All of that uplift is effectively socialized, is there to fund the infrastructure, debts paid off in a couple of decades, job done. All those powers are there right now. They were used again to build the Olympic development very effectively.
Compulsory purchase, yeah. Essentially, we're talking about. Okay.
But that captures the uplift for those new developments, but leaves the rest. I mean, I guess the thing that's most frustrating is, you talked about this shift that's happened over the 20th century from landlords capturing rent as landlords to people being homeowners. But of course, now what happens is just land rents are captured by banks instead. So it's not like we've gotten any, we haven't solved the problem of private capture of land rents. And I mean, I think it's actually a really tricky thing to do. And I think, introducing a land value tax is a tough one because, I personally think it makes perfect economic sense, but I just think the opposition is going to be huge. I am interested in some more innovative ideas which I've heard discussed, I've been discussing with friends at the New Economics Foundation, and I've discussed with Toby and Stephen actually, about trying to separate the ownership of land and housing slowly over time, and basically rent people still owning the bricks and mortar in the house that they live on, but paying a land rent on the...
But not the land it's built on.
Exactly. But there are different ways you could go about achieving that state.
Kate, Jay, what would you introduce?
I think there's a really interesting point here, which is there's an ideal that people might have, and that I think, again, as I restated in my presentation, I think if we all sat down and tried to design it across the panel, that would probably be the way that we would design it, because it's efficient, most economists would agree, and it's a useful way to move forwards. There's a really big question, which is how you move to that point. And there's already some taxes that are in place, so whether that be, you know, community infrastructure levy, or whether it's Section 106 agreements, or whatever it might be. However inefficient that might seem, that's based on a series of negotiations that, and deal-making that happens. Now, I think we really need to understand that difference between an ideal and moving to that ideal. I also think there needs to be recognition of the time period. So potentially there's a transition period here. Let's assume that an ideal happens. There's a transition period where people are currently making deals and doing deals on land or buying land or trying to get permission based on a current system. If that changed overnight, there would be significant issues. And that's not just for the developer going under. That's not just for, oh, boo to banks, they're going under. Mm. That means pension funds. That means my savings. That means your savings. So there's a real issue here about transition period. We need to be, I think we need to be a little bit more upfront and honest about that. We need to understand who wins and loses from changes to policy. I think that, through that rationality and that sincerity, do you make change in policy? But it's a long game.
How can we make it happen faster? Kate and Stephen, short of a revolution.
I was going to say, yeah, it feels like that taking into account the transition is incredibly important. But also not shying away from the need for a transition because it's hard. I think one immediate thing we could do would be to support planners and local authorities and invest more in planning departments to actually uphold that, uphold the public interest, which often they're really hard pressed to do, and they don't have the skills. They know they'll get taken to appeal if they turn down an unsuitable development, and that they probably don't have the legal. The money to pay for the lawyers to win those appeals. And so I think there's something immediate about just an inherent unfairness built in, sort of accidentally built into the system that could be addressed. But yeah, ultimately we need some kind of form of land value capture that
genuinely... Through a tax, eventually.
Through some kind of taxing, I would think, yeah. I suppose the other thing I would say is just that not-for-private profit models of development, like community land trusts, can often be both more flexible and take more risks than traditional developers can, because they don't have the need for such a big profit. They still need to make a profit, but they don't have that kind of, that chunk of that bit of that diagram is maybe not quite as big, which allows for more
the
flexibility.
The 20%, which is currently enshrined in the way the viability industry works. Stephen.
Okay. Well, 2017 is the bicentenary of David Ricardo's Law of Economic Rent. So this is a really good year to be doing something. But also just thinking about Henry George, the Lincoln Institute in Boston, in Cambridge, Boston, is the custodian of Henry George's work. And they're great supporters of community land trusts for exactly the reasons you say. I think what they see that is, if you can't bring about huge structural change through the action of government, you can provide the opportunities for people to do this voluntarily. So the way in which they've been working, usually at a kind of quite small scale in rural settlements, you know, a community uses the vehicle of the Community Land Trust, defined in law in the 2008 Housing and Regeneration Act. It is, in fact, the only institution described in English and Welsh law which describes an organisation that can only hold assets for the common good. It was deliberately put in there. The parliamentary draftsman really didn't like it because it didn't sort of have any power. It was just there on the statute book, but that was exactly what we had in mind. It's a kind of a sleeper. It's not perfect, but it's there. Mm. People can use it for all sorts of things, not just housing. And what it basically does, it gives local democratic legitimacy to communities to say, we will stop the land market working in the normal way in our place because we think this is what works for the common good of our place. You have to give it has to be something that can satisfy the public good test. It has to give itself legitimacy to do something quite extreme. And interestingly, government then lifted that wording definition and gave it to organisations that can give themselves planning permission through community right to build orders. Also, quite a big thing. State gives away its planning functions to the community.
Do you think we haven't quite woken up to how powerful both of those mechanisms could
not
potentially be?
Not at all. And we've been quite pleased that they haven't so far.
Word is going to get out after this. Watch out. Can we talk a bit about land banking, which seems to be quite a divisive issue that, according to The Guardian, it's the most iniquitous thing in the country. There's currently 600,000 plots of land with planning permission that the volume house builders are sitting on. We instantly got, you know, hundreds of messages from the volume house builders saying, no, this is part of our business model. We couldn't possibly survive without that many plots of planning permission in our pipeline, because that's the way it works. Are we being too harsh on developers and volume house builders? Is land banking not actually a problem?
I think I should go first on this. it's not a problem, and I'll explain why. So when you try and plan for a site, that period of time takes a long time. And that's a risk factor in itself. As I alluded to, the market cycles, there's risk attached. Therefore, there needs to be some gain of revenue afterwards. That's pretty fair to say. Secondly, when permission is granted through the various methods that I suggested up there, which took a long time, when permission is granted, different sites will build out at different rates. So large sites will have a large number of units being built out per year, but takes longer to plan into the system, takes longer to get to that, multiple phases. At some point, you've got to put in some community-based infrastructure, which is absolutely right, but it's very different to very small sites. Now, house builders build homes, and they will only build them at the rate that they can sell them. So if they can't sell them, you tell me a business that would actually make something. They won't. As a result, this is what happens when you have such a large issue of undersupply of housing. We need big sites, particularly. But also, we need lots of small sites, too. But when you're planning for big sites take longer. That's why they take longer to plan, and they take longer to actually build out. Now, of course, when you recite the figures about number of units with planning permission that aren't built on yet or haven't been built out, that's absolutely right. But you absolutely need a pipeline, because not 100% of units on that site is built out in that year. Of course, you're going to have units that are waiting to be built out. When you have the profile over 4 or 5 years of that build out, depending on site size, there's always going to be some overlap in that. And of course, I should also flag that there's some units that just lapse. Now, DCLG, the Department for Community and Local Government, state that this could be anywhere between 20 to 30 to 40% of units. Now, we can go into the discussion as to why that might happen, but there's a myriad of reasons. I mean, something on the land that isn't accounted for, so you can't achieve as many units, or a whole bunch of things there where somebody suddenly doesn't either sell land or moves back or whatever it might be. Those units aren't built because they won't be sold either. So there's a really difficult process here that's full of complexity that we really shouldn't wrap up in a single headline that creates a villain, because ultimately villains won't get stuff built.
What would Shelter say to that?
I would say that everything Joe says is entirely true. It's a complicated system. Developers do need a pipeline. All of that is true. And yet, there is a fundamental problem here. Firstly, it's that there's a difference in the current land bank, which is basically what Joe's been describing, and the strategic land bank, which is the land which developers usually don't own, so they don't have to admit, you can't tell that they've got it, but they've done a deal with a landowner, usually a farmer. And it's an entirely private deal. There's no transactions. There's no record of this, so we don't know. The best we can do is look at their annual reports, where they're very happy to say, oh, we've got a vast strategic land bank. This land they don't own, but they control. Why do they control it? It's to stop other people getting their hands on it. It's to make sure that no one else comes in and outcompetes them. The only way the business model works is by, as Joe says, making sure you don't sell homes so fast that the price goes down, because you cannot allow your profit margin to fall. That you can only do that in this market because you can keep competitors out. You can't maintain the price of shoes by preventing other people from selling shoes and undercutting you. It's a competitive industry, the shoe business, right? But housing and land is different because land is so scarce. You can control the land market. If you ask honest developers, and they will tell you this privately, they'll never say it publicly, but privately, I had a conversation with one the other day, said, of course, yeah, we spend most of our brains and most of our effort goes into trying to secure those long-term strategic land banks through options deals. How do we do it? We look on Google Earth for the right sort of looking places, and then we go and knock on doors. There's no market, it's completely below the radar. 5 times out of 6, when we knock on that door, they've already sold it to somebody else. This market is completely stitched up already. No, so when people talk about land banking, it's not about the current sites with permission. That is a red herring. Mm. It is about the control of the land market, which prevents new entrants, that keeps prices up and enables developers to trickle out supply to keep prices high.
Through option agreements, which are kept secret, I guess, the main problem. I think, Joe, you wanted to respond briefly
respond to that, about the notion of strategic land banks. Let me give you an example, because there's lots of various examples as to why there would be that those units wrapped up that aren't able to be built yet. An example here, a land promoter tries to get a site that's in the greenbelt into the local plan, as I described. That local plan hasn't yet been completed after 15 years. So this land promoter is trying to get land in. The council accepts the principle and includes that greenbelt release as part of the plan, so it's going to go ahead. Council's overall plan, though, across a whole range of other things, then gets thrown out, so the plan ends up binned. The inspector bins it, it's no longer happening. Ultimately, there's no development, although those units will be wrapped up in an options agreement, either with a land promoter or a house builder, that's still in the pipeline, that in the future will hopefully still be in the pipeline when either politics change or the local plan actually gets finished or different officers have different views on that. That's why that's in there. It's really long term and it's really difficult, but that's just one example of many as to why you've gone down the process and now you're still waiting.
What do you three make of it? Are we being too unfair to the volume house builders?
No, I mean, in a sense, we're being unfair to them because, in a sense, their business model isn't suited to land development. It's not what it's about. It's about building houses. So they're trying to do something with which their financing mechanisms are inherently unsuited. So they haven't, at any time in the last 30 years, acquired more than a certain number of plots each year in the kind of mid-hundred thousands. So if we're looking to do anything that's 250,000, or you go back to the period in the 50s and 60s, and we're clearly building 300,000, people then said, oh, it's because it's council housing. I think they missed the point. The point was the state was creating the land supply. It could have built anything on the land supply they created, but they used the powers of the state to create the land supply. And a lot of it was being created for house builders as well, in new towns as well. So the house building industry has never really had the capability to be an efficient creator of land supply. So if we want another 100,000, somebody else has got to do it. The house building industry will not do it, and we shouldn't pretend that they will. And apart from anything else, the extra layer of complexity in all this is that they're getting options in particular places to secure market share. Their share price depends as much on the perception of market share as anything else.
Okay, how can we tackle that? I mean, how can communities get access to land more easily, would you say?
Well, this is one of the huge challenges because it's so untransparent. I mean, it's hard enough to find out who owns a piece of land that they already own. When you add in the complexity of the options market, it becomes really quite murky. And I think this is one of the key challenges. We have the planning system. We have a system there. It's not strong enough to be allocating land for the public good. It's at the mercy of the market, and the market is dysfunctional. So it feels like, the developers aren't the bad guys here. They're just doing the logical thing for their business model in the market. The problem is the business model and the way the financing works and the pressure particularly to kind of sell very quickly. I think it comes down to this thing of seeing homes as commodities again. You know, the idea that it should be profitable to buy, to build and then sell homes. Mm. How we change that without a wider conversation about this stuff, I don't know. I don't think you can deal with it in isolation.
Beth.
I don't have much to add, but I did want to just flag up, there's a website called Who Owns England, which is a blog that a friend, Guy Shrubsole, has set up. So check that out. He's sort of trying to crowdsource help and information to start mapping who owns land in England.
Oh, and actually, can I just plug? We've also got a website called landexplorer.uk, which is at the beginnings of something that should hopefully give people, type in a postcode, get much more information about the land around you, starting with various open data sets. But yeah, sorry, I should have said that first.
Well, I can see various hands beginning to go up. So we've got a roving microphone. The first one was over here, and then we'll go to this one.
Hello, I'm a third-year architect student doing a dissertation on CLTs. I wanted to ask a question you brought up was, you just said, how can we change the psychological approach without having a wider land debate? I want to talk like the specificities of actually changing that cultural shift. You know, you use analogies like, oh, you know, your shoe seller wouldn't like cut off the supply of leather to stop other shoe sellers from making the same problem, and it seems fundamentally different that the connotations of supply and demand are so weird in regard to land. How do you like shake up the public into seeing just how fucked it all is? And also, how do you, that's the basic question of like, how do you make them realise that it's all messed up? Yeah, sorry, I was going to say, my generation, we all go, in London, you kind of laugh. It's kind of like a laughable thing of how much you are paying for your mortgage, but yet it's still acceptable. It's kind of like, oh, that's life, like a cow in the rain, just accepting it all, when really it needs to be more angry.
So is the question, how do we ferment revolution?
Yeah, what's the bigger sort of perspective, psychological?
Who wants to go first?
Well, I think that's a really good question. I mean, it really upsets me when I hear language like people start describing when the house market slows as that being stagnation, and when prices rise as that being recovery, as if we've completely normalised the idea that house prices should be 10 times average earnings and still rising. So for most of the 20th century, for at least 7 decades of the data that I've managed to get, house prices were only 5 times average earnings. They fluctuated around that really consistently for 7 decades, and it was only in the mid-90s that this crazy new turn happened. So I think we have to sort of keep in mind that it is not normal and is not sustainable. And as I was trying to explain there, so much of these prices are now underpinned by speculative demand and debt-fueled demand. And the feedback loops that I didn't really get around to explaining that push prices up, so banks create more money, that pushes prices up, that the expectation of capital gains brings investors in, that pushes prices up, that means that people have to borrow more and more money pushed in. Those feedback loops happen in reverse just as powerfully. So if prices start to falter, investors will sell en masse, and once prices start to fall, banks will become very nervous about lending because, of course, their security is the asset of the house. And that will push things into reverse. So, you know, I think one of the key ways that we can ferment revolution, if you like, or we can make the case for really radical structural change is by saying, look, a big crash is on its way. And where's the plan, guys? You know, do you have a plan for stopping people getting pushed into negative equity? There are ways of dealing with this, but it requires some thought.
Shelter is a campaign. That's what we're here for. We don't actually normally spend our time pontificating about kind of the philosophy of property ownership. Honest, you know, we are here to try and build up that anger and direct it in useful ways. And we spend a lot of time worrying about why these issues don't get more political cut through. And we do an awful lot of research into looking into it. And the honest truth is that the people who lose out, i.e., mainly the young, don't vote, they don't write to their MPs, they don't count in the political system. Whereas if you try and build 10 affordable homes on the edge of a village, that MP will be bombarded with hate mail from very angry voters, all of whom are members of the local branch party and turn up to every meeting. So if you really actually want to affect the political system, you have to engage with it. come to Shelter and join us as a campaigner.
Stephen.
Okay. I mean, the housing market is the one in which consumers are uniquely powerless, in my view. So the only thing that we can do is to give ourselves agency to intervene directly in the markets ourselves. I mean, I would say this because I'm involved a lot in all kinds of community housing things, but all these things, cooperatives, co-housing projects, community land trusts, what they are is basically a protest against what the market and policy is not giving people. What they want is something else. So if they're going to get it, then you're going to have to find ways of doing it. And most surprisingly, a parting gift from our Chancellor in the budget last year was an unexpected amount of money devoted to community housing. Initially, a kind of electoral bung to the Southwest for returning 16 Conservative MPs instead of Lib Dems. But somehow, in the course of the year,
rural and coastal has been redefined to include London and one or two other urban, rather surprising urban areas. And so actually there's a kind of political space now, genuinely, but people have to fill the space by doing stuff. You know, here in London, you know, I expect quite a few of you know about Naked House, they might even be here. You know, this is a group of people who decided that they were not going to put up with what the development industry were offering them or what they could buy in the second-hand market. So they've found a way, they've had to work hard over a number of years, finding a local authority in the end that will do a deal with them on land to produce a kind of housing that they think is genuinely more affordable, not just for them, but for the people who come after.
And the pot of money you mentioned, that's what, £60 million a year for the next 5 years? It's not a small amount.
It's not small, but in a sense, the really important thing, giving credit to this government, is that because Osborne had no idea what to do with it, civil servants didn't know what to do with it, so it's been a really extraordinary process of co-designing a programme with the sector, with people who are actually delivering stuff. And the civil servants are saying now, what the minister wants to do is to grow a sector. So part of the money is about providing the infrastructure for that sector to grow on growing and to be able to deliver once that money is gone. So get to it.
Joe, did you want to?
Yeah, I don't think that we can underestimate the power of comms here and the level of sincerity that's required. I think whenever you try to affect change, and I'm certainly not an expert in this field, and others would be, but whenever you try and affect change, ultimately you have two routes. Either you can go down the route of big bang, it's going to be a shock, this is all gone to pot, it's going to end in disaster. Or you can try and swallow some of that and make some pragmatic, incremental changes on the way to an ideal. And why I say that is that's very important when you come to think about housing. Because house prices are not nuts everywhere. I mean, I could choose to live elsewhere and actually buy a home. I choose to rent in London. Now, why do I choose to rent in London? Well, A, it's London. But then B, that's my job. So there's a whole bunch of things going on here in the economy that's not just about fueling the housing market, the big crash is coming. When you look at London and now the wider southeast, that's really hotting up. But central London in particular, and it's slowing down. But central London is a real issue. When you look elsewhere, if you go try and live in Manchester or you try and live in Leeds or whatever, sure, prices are higher than they were 20, 30 years ago, probably higher than you'd expect them to be compared to earnings. Earnings certainly haven't caught up. But is it on the London scale? It absolutely isn't on the London scale. So my point about how to affect change is be sincere. And that's why I think the big bang shock approach will not work, because a policymaker within government that already is trying to tread this fine line between new policy and just keep with the existing system because I'm in a job, they will hear this and go, well, prices aren't crazy everywhere. Let's just plow on with the current system.
Okay, big bang shock or slow and steady?
I'm like instinctively not a kind of heads on spikes person.
That sounds really scary.
However,
you can make exceptions.
But I do think that analogy about a cow in the rain is a really good one, actually, that we have for so long treated land and the way it is controlled as something like the weather, you know, like, oh, it rains sometimes. And actually, it's a man-made system. And it's taken an awful long time to build up, as Toby pointed out. And I would therefore think it needs a long time to transition into something else. I think the one thing that makes me feel, and yet I think London is a special case, and it feels to me it's not so much like a north-south divide, it's a high land values, low land values area sort of divide, and that areas with low land values are struggling in different ways. And this is before we even start to get into the impact of agricultural subsidies and the common agricultural policy and the way that, and monopolistic rural landowners and the way they can put an absolute stranglehold on anything new happening in the areas where they own land. You know, there are multiple issues to do with this. But it does feel to me that the more middle-class people are getting angry that their children can't buy homes or their grandchildren can't buy homes and that they have no control over the system that has treated them very well, the more anger that is building up there, it feels like that might be something that is also potentially pushing for some maybe more incremental changes, but that we might be at a point where it's just getting a bit too ridiculous. Yeah, like the only thing you can do in London is laugh. And that's, you're not going to be able to laugh for much longer.
the next question was just here. Yes, yeah. And then.
Hi. Anthony Molloy from the Labour Land Campaign, a group that advocates land value taxation. And I understand the emphasis that you all gave, your housing guys. Yeah, an LVT, land value taxation, would go a long way to solving the housing crisis. But I would like to point out that that is a minor corollary benefit of land value taxation. Yeah? The essential benefits of land value taxation is that every penny you take off economic rent, off sterile asset-based economy, allows you not to take a penny out of the real economy based on trade, labour, productivity, enterprise, etc. And I know, you know, we're talking about housing here, but don't lose sight of the real value of land value taxation.
Yeah, let's get on to land value tax. So Adam Smith said nothing could be more reasonable than a land value tax. And as you mentioned already, Milton Friedman said it was the least bad tax. So what do we make of it? What's standing in the way of introducing it?
Theoretically, and from an most economists would agree that it's a sensible approach. I think most people would agree that it's a sensible approach. I think trying to capture that value that's provided through uplift, through investment, is an absolutely worthwhile thing. I think that that funding, as the gentleman here pointed out, would then go straight into the real economy, productive use. I get that. What's standing in the way of it? Well, I think it's partly politics. Politics is a barrier here, but let's remember that it's a democratic process, and that's very difficult to overcome, probably hence the conversations about revolution, and that's really very difficult. Secondly, is about the change in system always provides winners and losers immediately, and so it's the degree to which those losers then can mobilize, but also impact on other aspects of the economy. I really don't think that the conversation needs to be whether LVT is a good thing, theoretically, or indeed it should be part of the mix. I think the conversation should be, if you want to get to that point, how do you get to that point?
The fundamental barrier to land value taxation is homeowners, because most homeowners are not getting a cash income from their home. They are made better off, they are wealthier as a result of it, and they are obviously benefiting from having a home, and they're making a huge, at the moment, value gain on their asset base, but they're not getting a cash income. If you then hit them with a cash tax every year, they're really going to feel it. There's an awful lot of pressure on council tax, and that's a fraction of what a land value tax would need to be effective. So that's the fundamental political barrier. Again, it's not a theoretical barrier, but it's a huge political obstacle, because you're talking about hitting 60% of the country with a massive tax bill.
Beth?
I mean, one thing you could do is make the tax immediately redistributed on an equal per capita basis, so then you create a massive constituency of people who are getting immediate kickback and might quite like the idea of it. I haven't given that any deep thought, just, you know,
that's the answer.
off the top of my head.
Yeah.
Good job.
But I think, I mean, like I said before, I think there might be other ways of getting to, I mean, basically, once people who own land privately are in a minority, it becomes much easier to bring in a land value tax. And we're heading in that direction, right? Because home ownership is now on the decline. I think that
it's about 50% now.
So. Right. I think if there's, the CLT model, I feel quite excited about, and I think that there are things that we could do to scale it up, so that, you know, a big kind of citizens community land trust, you could ask them to buy a house on your behalf. They pay for the land, you just pay for the bricks and mortar, and you start paying a land rent to them. And equally, you could sell the land from underneath your home to them and start paying a land rent if you wanted to get out of debt. And if something like that grew, because it would be, theoretically, it would be very attractive to people who are stuck in the private rented sector paying crazy rents, who wanted to at least own the bricks and mortar.
Let's do a test. Who in the audience would pay into that kind of community land trust? Okay, let's set one up.
So, but my sort of feeling is, if something like that was to grow, then we could be in a situation after some years, maybe 10, 20 years, where people who own land outright were in a real minority, and then a land value tax becomes a bit more feasible. The rest of the land value is captured within a land trust anyway. So I think those are the sort of ideas that I think are worth exploring.
And and I think this is the thing, like land value tax, there are many different options, right? And there are many different potential approaches. And we're sort of quite deliberately not experts on land value tax, actually, because we sort of thought strategically it could kind of entirely consume us. But it's, I think there's no doubt that both council tax and business rates are really regressive. You know, they, you as the occupier pay rather than the landowner or the building owner. So they benefit from all of the uplift in the value and don't pay any tax on that. I know Andy Whiteman did a paper for the Green Party in England looking at the, which is a, actually quite interesting read if anyone's up for it, which seemed to show that you could do it in a way that wouldn't cost much more for most people than they're currently paying in council tax. And so I think it does come back down to political will. And yeah, it feels like that might be moving towards a bit of a tipping point. But yeah, if I was designing this from scratch, you'd have a land value tax and a universal basic income, which would be funding some kind of universal basic income, and we'd all live in a lovely utopian environment. But like, we are where we are.
Stephen.
I'm going to agree absolutely with you, but I think the point I made in my talk is that where is the political brain that would come up with a really compelling version of what does a reconfigured tax system look like? So you have the land value tax, clearly some taxes you don't want to tax, trying not to tax income, trying not to tax production, tax pollution. You know, there are lots of things that need to happen, but you know, at some stage somebody's got to start. So it is about what are the first steps, making sure that it, you know, doesn't affect people too adversely. But you know, the public press being what it is, you know, you'll have the poor widows waived again. You know, even in Churchill's time, you know, he was confronted with this. He said, oh, no, not the poor widows again. Let the poor old lady alone. Let her rest. Because you know, the kind of shroud-waving aspects of this are very powerful and compelling. So it's about doing lots of things where you can't just derail the system by, you know, trying to do the one thing.
There's also lots of other perverse taxes on land that you could deal with as well, around inheritance tax and capital gains tax. So it's not just land value tax.
Okay, the next question was just behind you, and then the red lady at the back.
Thank you. I have a question. Like you said, people want to live inside the city now, so I guess there's no point building on the Greenbelt because it's not the kind of lifestyle that normal days people want. So I have a question, like, what is the difficulty of densify the land you already owned? Like, just increase the density of on the land that you already built on.
What's standing in the way of increasing density?
Again, it's the same problem, it's homeowners. Most of that land is occupied by individual homes owned by individual people. It's really complicated to rebuild a neighborhood unless you're prepared to forcibly, compulsively purchase all of those homeowners, knock down their homes and build something bigger. And that's really difficult. It's really expensive. They really hate it. The press will be on you all the time. And, you know, estate regeneration is rightly a controversial and difficult process. And that's the relatively easy bits because it's got kind of unitary state ownership. And try do that in a suburb, which is a kind of low-density sprawl, occupied by 3,000 individual homeowners who've spent the last 40 years paying off their mortgages, they will crucify you. It is, unfortunately, really, really practically, politically very difficult.
I think there's a political angle to this too, in terms of mobilisation and what the public want, because a lot of the conversation, particularly in London, is, oh, we absolutely can't build on Greenbelt. I mean, it's rolling countryside, and that's a conversation in itself, but we can't build on Greenbelt, OK. But also, we don't want to build too high in central London. Oh, right, OK. Oh, well, let's just not build stuff then. And that's a really difficult thing to overcome, particularly by people that are incentivized to talk about those things in terms of, oh, well, I don't want to ruin the feeling of London or how London looks to me. Oh, yeah, London is definitely a three-story city. I mean, when you compare London to other cities, it's unbelievable. I mean, when you compare it to, like, Barcelona, granted, it's borders the sea and some mountains, so it's a slightly different issue. But they build up really very quickly. There's a fundamental lesson there. So I think conversations, back to my sincerity point, conversations need to move to, okay, if we're going to keep Greenbelt for it, as in we're not going to build on greenbelt, we've got to build higher. Or if we don't want to build higher, let's start chipping away at some of that greenbelt that could be used better. But it's that trade-off kind of conversation that I think that we need to start having in order to move things forwards. Otherwise, you're always pitting a villain against a hero that will never change anything.
But it's also about communicating the benefits of development, I suppose. That's something that came up last week. You know, how can we be more vocal about actually telling people, you know, what's in their interests when a new building arrives? You know, we should have Section 106 payments written on billboards, you know, saying actually, you know, there are silver linings to this monster tower block potentially.
But the point is, there are silver linings for the community, but not for the people who are going to object, because it's just, I have my house, it's fine, I don't want it knocked down, I don't want a tower block in front of it. This is the fundamental problem of rent again, is that some people are very nicely served by this system. They're making money hand over fist from seeing their asset values go up. They're well housed, and they're able politically to resist change. So, you know, and it's all very well saying, oh, other people will benefit, sorry, love, but, you know, the people quite rightly will resist.
Yeah, Kate.
And I think this is one of the things that we mean when we talk about having a level of community control in this idea of common good land use, is having some real discussions about the trade-offs and the compromises that sit around land use. And I think the Greenbelt is a really good example. Like, too often it is just, it's horsey culture, it's people's horses, it's essentially privatized. It's not the rolling countryside of all our dreams, and engaging people in grown-up conversations about how the land around them should be used, not just at the end of a planning consultation where it's like, do you want 36% affordable housing or 38% affordable housing? It needs to be a much earlier point than that. And I think really being able to articulate the benefits and acknowledge the disbenefits that might occur. That just sort of properly trusting people to have those conversations feels like a really important thing. Mm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Anything else to add, or should we go to?
Okay, just one thing. It's so slightly about design, but I think it's certainly the experience of many community schemes, and rather as Kate's saying, you know, is if communities feel that they're part of the process and making things happen and shaping it, you know, often the approach is completely different. So there are two quite big community land trust projects in London. In both cases, the community involved in community planning was saying, you need to be building more here than the local authority was planning to do, which is a great surprise to developers and their planning consultants. But I think equally, there are certain forms of housing, and co-housing is one of them, where people co-designing the kind of place that they want to live in, which is based around relationships between the people living there, will often design things in a way that makes much more efficient land use, more compact, more intimate relations between the dwellings, and more shared space and less individual space. So I think there are lots of opportunities for doing that.
Okay, the question from the stadium seating at the back.
Hi, my name is Pippa Gusebock. So in order to achieve land value taxation, revolution seems difficult. The Daily Mail will get in the way of that. And it looks like policy change, politicians aren't going to achieve a relabeling of tax into land value taxation. So I just wonder if there's a stealth way of doing it. You talked about capital gains tax. Is there a way of slowly over the course of time to morph capital gains tax into land value tax, so that the change isn't so catastrophic, so that all the landowners and house builders and house owners don't feel so impinged upon, and so there's not such a backlash. And I have a second question, which is that I just wondered where else in the world or in Europe is doing this land value taxation, presumably somewhere in Northern Europe, because they're quite progressive.
So, stealthy mutation of the tax system. How can we do that? Is that in your land reform bill, Stephen?
It isn't, no. We thought one step at a time. But, I mean, in a sense, I mean, you're perfectly right. And certainly, what you're trying to do is to shift the burden of tax from the thing, you know, away from the things that are useful and productive, like, you know, people's earnings and productivity of companies. I mean, they're largely optional taxes anyway. And actually turn it onto these things that are about that's meaningless in real economy terms, wealth accumulation. But you could do it very, very quickly, in the sense if the rate is very, very low, and there is some compensating offset with reductions in other taxes. It would take time. These transition things would take time. So you'd have to do it that way anyway.
But if it was so low at the beginning that it kind of barely registered, because the real problem is people suddenly finding cash out of incomes that may not sustain it, whereas they've got asset wealth.
Beth.
Yeah, I mean, I'd just say the one problem that I have with the land value tax is at the moment, if you're a renter and your neighbourhood is gentrifying, you have absolutely no security and you can be pushed out of your neighbourhood. And that is what people desperately try to escape when they go into home ownership. If you had a high land value tax that was updated according to changes in land value, then you would be exposed, even as a homeowner, to that same insecurity because the land value could rise if you were in Hackney. But that obviously is only a real threat if the land value tax is very high. To have all of its economic benefits, it ought to be high. So that's a challenge that I've never heard quite answered by land value tax advocates. But like I say, I think there are other ways of slowly taking land into collective stroke national ownership and capturing the land value in that way, but it has to happen incrementally.
Just to answer the second part of your question, Denmark is the country that does have these land value taxation, and unfortunately it uses it in a very small degree. It's a really quite minor tax. It's smaller than council taxes here. And it's massively hated and resisted, even though it's really minor. So it is really difficult to get the benefits of it unless you're prepared to go quite full on. And then it runs into real political opposition.
Any other examples? The next question was just there.
Hi. I think Andreas and I have the same question. So I'm going to... first of all, thanks so much for your presentations and for articulating such a complex issue, particularly for the students here. And I have to thank you particularly for not using too many acronyms and complicated sort of abbreviations for people who aren't familiar with the field. So on that note, and maybe drawing on from Stephen's last answer, do you think, because most of the points that you've been making have been to do with general citizenship, are there any pointers that you can give to the design students in the room? Is there any agency that comes from understanding the issues that you're talking about that perhaps architects or urban designers can use perhaps more directly? A bit of a challenge, or maybe some examples that you can think of.
Can I just add? I had the same question.
Okay, great.
But maybe also what they shouldn't do anymore.
Should we boycott speculative development altogether and only work for community land trusts? Wants to go.
I'll go first. I think there's a natural standoffishness from people about new housing in general, and that comes from a variety of places. It could be infrastructure burden, or it could be the fear of others, or whatever it might be. But a lot of people don't like additional housing, period. So what I would suggest is, from a design or architecture perspective, is to really make the case that well-designed place-making places that are really beautiful for people to live in, that understand that you can communicate it in that way, that yes, there will be more homes, but look what's going to be down on the side of your street, for example. I think that really does make the case well. And I think it comes back exactly to my overall point, which is this is a series of really difficult conversations with a bunch of people that have very different incentive structures and things that motivate them. And we have to, if you want to change any system, you absolutely have to be prepared to have those series of conversations on very different topics with those very different people in order to get that shift happening.
For me, the one thing would be think 15, 20 years down the line and think about what you're designing and how it will actually be managed and how it will actually be lived in. And I suppose I'm particularly speaking from a kind of landscape and green space point of view, but we've seen some terrible, terrible designs in pretty mediocre housing developments, but with green space that is full of silver birch trees, purely there to sell the first round of houses and then to be neglected. And it's like there's such potential in those spaces to create. That's where the communities are created. It's not what happens inside the houses, it's what happens in the spaces in between. But from particularly the landscape architects, being strong with the developers and making a case for that landscaping potentially even being done first. It's not an afterthought, it can't be. And it too often is. And I think for the design profession to stick really strongly to that could have a huge impact.
Can Can I say, just be controversial within a room full of young architects, don't be afraid of traditional. Mm. I'm afraid when it comes to housing, most people like traditional old housing. I rather like modern style housing. Most people bloody hate it, and that's a large part of why most people resist new housing development, because they just don't see it as housing for them, they don't like it. We can all point to fabulous examples of contemporary modern housing. Most of it, of what gets built out there, is not like that. What most people really like is stuff that's in keeping with the neighbourhood, and most of the profession, quite rightly, deride as pastiche. So my tip would be overcome the hatred of traditional and engage with places as they are, not just as they look on the page.
Or engage with people and educate them that actually contemporary architecture is the way forward. Stephen.
Just tell them they're wrong enough and they'll understand, yeah, right?
Exactly.
Yeah. That's definitely worked before. Yeah.
I didn't quite hear the question entirely, but I think I heard the word citizenship. And I just echoing what Kate was saying, for a few years I ran a week-long design studio for mid-career design professionals, the integrated interdisciplinary design of the built environment master's course in Cambridge. So these are people in their kind of mid-30s, early 40s, engineers, planners, surveyors, landscape architects, and so on, all learning how to work together more effectively. But their task was to imagine themselves designing a city in 2050 when we would have decarbonized the economy, and trying to imagine what they, nearing the end of their careers, how they would themselves imagine living, and then to design a quarter of the city for the way they thought they would be living at that time. And there was a course of 5 years and probably 100 students, all kind of five groups of three or four each year. Every single group, without exception, all said that we would be living in completely different circumstances to now. They reimagined the way in which neighborhoods would work, much more sharing, collectivization of assets. They all agree that if you actually think about it, the way we're living now is not sustainable, and cities will kind of implode in all sorts of interesting ways. So they were actually modeling a completely different way of operating. When we came to role play how that might actually work in a city being reconstructed after an earthquake, and actually taking the opportunity to rethink a city now, as well as getting people back into their homes very quickly, it was very interesting. Everybody wanted to be the community organizer. And that's what I would urge young students to do, is go and find organizations that are involved in community organizing and learn how to affect the political process.
Okay, two more questions. One with the microphone and then one.
Hello? Hi, just a quick one. So London boroughs own a lot of land. So what proactive things could they do to help out with that resource?
What could local authorities be doing with their own land? How can they be more proactive? And which ones are already? Which are the model examples? Some of them are in the room. Who wants to go first?
I don't have lots to say on this. I just want to sort of reinforce the idea that we absolutely desperately need the public sector to take a lead, because the idea that the private sector is going to deliver house building on the scale that we need is completely batshit crazy.
The simple answer is don't sell it. Local authorities who just sell land to the highest bidder and pride themselves that they've got fair value and they've got a good deal for their local citizens are just part of the problem. If there is public land, for God's sake, hang on to it. Don't value it according to what Savills tell you it might be worth if you kind of rinse the planning system and haggled it down and for affordable housing and built some poxy flats on it. Actually think about what you want to do for your place and value it accordingly.
And also, don't just think about housing. We need spaces to grow food. We need spaces to relax. And I think particularly if we're designing this...
Next week's topic.
Yeah, but also if we're designing this new decarbonised economy where everyone's sharing and being much more co-housing-y, we're going to need to have a more decentralised food system and a more decentralised energy system. And we need spaces for those things in our cities. We can't just push it all out, particularly because you can't do lots of that stuff on the Green Belt anyway. If London is going to remain a place that people want to live, we cannot just fill every available bit of land with housing. And so, more proper land for food growing, please.
I mean, it's difficult for local authorities because they have so little power, so few fiscal powers. They're basically not autonomous at all. So they're completely dependent on central government grants of some form, except for council tax and half of business rates. It's really difficult for them to do anything. However, if you looked at like European models, for example, the state takes a much more proactive role. So to some degree, if a local authority wanted to sell land, if they could replace that land, probably nobody would have a problem with them selling land because they're going to replace land and put it back into the system. So there's an argument there to be made, but that then you end up jumping down the rabbit hole, which is, you know, fiscal autonomy, whether Treasury is going to give up any of its autonomy. It's a really difficult one to unpick. But fundamentally, you should sell it if you think it's most appropriate to sell it, but equally look for ways to try and replace it where you can.
I think there might be some people disagreeing. Well, I can see a serious frown in the middle.
I get that a lot.
Do you want to respond?
Only that we've just talked for ages about the importance of trying to capture the unearned value lift in land value and share it for collective good. So selling public land at this moment just seems like the wrong approach.
What if the public managed to get hold of that land 100 years ago and today it's worth many, many, many millions, notwithstanding the point about the regular income stream that land value tax would have. Equally, that's an uplift that would be spent on the local community in some way. So maybe the conversation would then be, how do you spend that money? And if they're just spending it on the revenue side, which ends up not investing in the community again, that'll be a difficult thing. If you've had huge cuts to departments and you're just selling off land and then funding it into that angle, that's a really difficult thing. If you're selling public land to invest in something else for the long term, that's surely not a bad thing.
Stephen.
Okay. Well, I come back to my prefiguring of the revolution. We have to find an example that shows local authorities that they might even make more money if they dispose of their land or use their land in different ways. I mean, there's a significant project in London at the moment which potentially could do exactly that, promoted by local community, local business people, the opportunity to do that, and if they want to talk about it, they're here in the room. But potentially, that could give the local authority more money over the longer term. But at the moment, you feel that authorities are incredulous. They can't believe that the way the market works isn't the best way to operate.
I think the group you're referring to currently has the microphone, so we'll let them ask their question.
Okay, Christian Spence Davies, Camley Street Community Land Trust. It feels like the conversation has been very much about privately owned natural developer and monopoly, and even private owners wanting to make money. Not much talk about local authorities. What would you do, very simply, if you were in charge of a local authority and you could do what you wanted to do and you could make your own understanding of what best value actually means?
How would you redefine best value if you were in charge of a borough?
Well, I'm an economist, so my route down this is probably obvious, although that's not to understate that. I mean, the economics as a profession is given a really bad rap, and for legitimate reasons across a whole range of areas. But to try and capture that value in a logical way so that it can be reinvested is no bad thing. So if it were up to me, what would I try and do? I would ask for greater autonomy from the central state.
Okay. That's absolutely a fundamental starting point. We have the most centralized form of government anywhere, I think, in the Western world. Local authorities are absolutely powerless in terms of their financial autonomy. That would be absolutely number one. The other thing, as I would say, is that the role of the chief executive of a local authority is to ensure that the whole range of policy objectives and its spatial plan are all meshed with the way it uses its assets and its resources. Spatial plans are about promoting the well-being of its communities, economic, social, environmental. What plans don't do is specify very carefully what the outcomes of those well-being policies might be. If they could do that, then it would be much simpler to make sure that when people come forward with investment proposals, and planning is only really a framework for investment, it's about how you invest effectively in a place, that people will only get their permission if they can show how they will deliver those outcomes. So you refocus the purpose of the industry. You're not going to get, land will not come forward to be developed if you can't show how you contribute to the well-being of your place. And it requires strong local political leaders to do that, who have to stand up for we need more homes, more investment, whatever. And we're a bit lacking in them.
I think I would do all of that. And then, but I think I would veer away from trying to do large developments and try and parcel up, even if you did have big bits of land, parcel it up so you could make them attractive both to smaller developers, to CLTs, to custom build approaches. So you had a bit more of a variety of approaches going on and a more of a mixed economy. I would also work with the school's budget and the hospital budget to make sure there was enough land that was growing healthy, sustainable food for the people in who were sick and who were young, and actually start to try and address some of the wider economic issues around access to healthy lives, because land is actually one of the most important ways of being able to do that. So I would de-silo everything. It would be really easy.
Beth, what would be your dream borough setup?
This is sort of beyond my field of expertise, really. But I mean, I would just maybe add that one power that is in local authorities' control already is to set council tax higher on second homes, and that could help in certain areas to cool the housing market.
Toby, finally.
If I had those land assets as a local authority, I wouldn't sell them. I would retain the freehold and hand them over to community groups to do whatever it is that's required there, whether it's food, housing, health services. But just retain that freehold as an asset there for the community in perpetuity and make sure it's delivering what that place needs.
Yeah. Which is hopefully what Camden are going to do with Camley Street. Fingers crossed. We might find out next week because Christian is sitting on the panel. I think it's time to continue the discussion in the bar. So all that's left for me to say is there are still tickets available for the next three events, I believe. So I hope to see you there and to thank our incredible panel and you guys for coming. Thank you.